Hello again, it's Mr. Pete, your interweb shop teacher, and this is tips number 830. I sincerely hope you watched numbers 828 and 829, where I spent a lot of time converting this 14-inch delta saw into a metal cutting saw from its original high-speed wood cutting. It was an abject failure, but it was fun to do. And the final problem, I believe, was just a lack of rigidity, or it could have been the wrong blade, but I'm not able to troubleshoot it. I gave up. But in this video, I'm going to take a short field trip right now to a neighbor's house where he has a Rockwell Delta 14-inch saw similar to this, only an older model, that is set up by the factory for both metalworking and woodworking. So I'm going to take some of these same pieces of metal and go over there right now. And we'll review that saw, take a look at it, and see how it works as a metal cutting saw compared to this one. Let's go. Before we head over to my friend's house, let's take a real quick look here at the conversion that I made. A 12-inch belt pulley. And down below here is the Sears slow speed converter. There's two videos on that as well. But that was my method of slowing this down to a metal cutting speed. Okay, I'm on a field trip at my neighbor and friend's house, Rich, and this is all about this Delta bandsaw that is a combination metal wood cutting saw. And now this is three phase, so I can't run it for you without moving this to a different location that has three-phase power or near a converter. So you're not going to see it in operation. But let me show you a few things about this saw that is a little bit different than my own. Now, there isn't any difference up here on the top wheel. By the way, he did install new blade guides that I think he got off of eBay, was it? Yeah, that are far better than the original ones that came from Delta Rockwell. Let me move in now on the lower wheel. Okay, this is a view of the lower wheel, and this is where you add the oil because this is a gearbox. I think you can tell that that is significantly different than the saw that I own. So that is how they reduce the speed. Now I'm going to turn this around. Notice that it's three phase. So that means it probably came from a commercial shop of some kind originally. This was bought used by my friend. And now looking at it from the back side, several things here now. We've got a four-step pulley right here. This is just one step, but again the gearbox is back here, so in order to shift it, you either pull this out or push it in, I forgot which, and that engages or disengages the gearbox and would make a direct drive. And now there's two shafts here. This shaft would go straight through to the center of the lower wheel, and this shaft goes into the gearbox, and no doubt there's a gear on the other end of it. I wish I had a parts breakdown of that, because that's about as much as I can tell you about it. But you can see why this saw would cost a lot more than the regular woodworking, and again, that's where you put in the gear oil. I did take down the model number, so if I'm able to find anything in an old Delta Rockwell catalog in regards to the specifications, I will put that in the description, or probably in still pictures at the end of the video, so check those out. Now I'm going to turn it around and show you the nice blade guides that he put on this machine. My friend put these blade guides on that are far superior to what they originally installed on these machines, which were die cast and subject to breakage. So I believe that Rich said that these are made out of solid billet stock, and they got double bearings here. And on the back, I'll get another view, another ball bearing, but the bearing is mounted in a different position than what you'll see on regular Delta saws. So from this view, you can see that there are double ball bearings right here, and look at the way they have mounted this back bearing that the blade pushes up against. Apparently the original guard right here would not fit, so there's an attachment here. I think they came with his kit. Let's see how that is mounted. Pretty nice, and the lower bearing about the same. This is the company from which he purchased the blade guides, if you're interested. And here's a view of the lower guide. The lighting may not be real good, but it is a great improvement on this machine. I should buy a set myself.
Okay. All right, that wraps up this video on the metal cutting, wood cutting saw. This is what the original lower guide looked like. Look at how complicated that is compared to the one that he put on here. So I hope you find that interesting. I wish that I could run this and see if there's any chatter or anything like that. But did it chatter, do you remember, on steel? Or was it a good cut?
All the way in low gear, it was fine.
Yeah, he said it was fine, so this is a better saw than mine. So. Okay, I'm back in my home shop, and I thought the video would be over by now, but actually it's only half over. You know how I like to beat things to death. Thank you to Richard for letting me photograph in his garage. Now, you will notice that he had a very coarse blade on that saw, and he was not going to run it at slow speed, I don't believe, because he was going to cut some exotic woods that they use in knife handles and so on, but that was his setup and his reason for doing that. And I'm sorry that it was three-phase. By the way, he did buy that used from Lost Creek Machinery. Check out their site. But the reason I'm prolonging this video is that I came home and I did a lot of research. So after 6 hours of research and pulling out some of my old Delta Rockwell catalogs from the 50s, I found the saws, and there are two different versions of those saws, so I want to show you some of the pictures and specifications of that. Furthermore, I went to Keith Rucker's wonderful site, vintagemachinery.org, and found parts breakdowns of these two different saws, because they made these saws in two different models over the years, maybe even three, in regards to how they achieved that speed reduction. So I want to show you pictures of that in the parts breakdowns, which I think for inquiring minds you will find very interesting. So let's get on with it. So we got about 10 more minutes to go. Lots of still pictures at the end in regards to those exploded views. Here is a 1954 Delta Milwaukee catalog. They still use the term Delta Milwaukee at that time, but notice that it already is part of Rockwell. And interestingly enough, look at the stamp on the front here, Williams Hardware Store. And that store burnt down in 1958 with one of the most spectacular fires that ever occurred in LaSalle County. It is still talked about, but that was the end of that store. They had a lot of gunpowder and other explosives in there that fueled the fire, and it was a 3 or 4 story building that burned to the ground. It was quite tragic. And this is the 1958 Delta Rockwell Industrial Tool Catalog. They stopped calling it Delta Milwaukee at that time. And the reason I'm telling you all of this is because that between these two catalogs, the dates 54 and 58, Delta had made a change in design on that 14-inch bandsaw that allowed them probably to make the thing cheaper. I'm not really sure of that, but that's usually the way changes are driven. But secondly, they were able to achieve much slower speeds with the later models. And maybe there was even a third model. Let me know if you know the difference. But the reason that I'm also telling you that is that in Richard's bandsaw across the street, he had very, very low speeds of 60 and 40 feet per minute. And he said that his bandsaw did chatter, except when he ran it at the very lowest speed. So there was something about the design of these saws that allowed that kind of chatter and vibration. If you have one of these saws and you do not have that problem, I would be very interested to know in the comments. All right, let's take a look at some of the specifications in these two catalogs, starting with the 1954. Okay, here it is in 1954, and an entire page is devoted to the 14-inch metal and wood cutting bandsaw, which cuts in a wide range of materials, is what they claim. Now, on the following page, which I will not show you, they talk strictly about the woodworking model. Now, I'm going to take photos of the close-up photos of this, and there'll be still pictures at the end of the videos if you want to study that, because I enjoy studying this, but I think that I am in the minority on that. I have no prices on these. The prices were always put on separate sheets in industrial catalogs, so they could change the prices at will. Now, notice the speeds here. I'm not going to talk about the woodworking speeds. I'm going to talk about the metalworking speeds with the 1725 motor. The lowest speed was 125 feet per minute, which is about the speed that I finally achieved in my experiment earlier in this video. But also note here that you could get a slower speed with an 1140 RPM motor, but if you know anything about motors, you will realize that 1140 RPM motors were 8-pole motors rather than 4-pole motors, and they cost considerably more. But that would be the ideal way to reduce speeds excuse me, on bandsaws and drill presses. And in 1969, I ordered a big Rockwell drill press for the school, and I did specify the 1140 motor, and I remember it costing more. Inquiring minds will want to read all about the gear unit here, which is different than the other one. And they're just saying here that back gear is engaged by disengaging by a half turn of a lever. A flip of a lever changes it from a slow speed for metal cutting to a high speed. But it says that separate belts must be used, so it wasn't that easy to change the speed. And they were probably trying to get away from that. All right, now let's take a look at the specs in the 1958 catalog. Anybody listening? This is the 1958 Rockwell catalog, and perhaps this is the year that they introduced the new model. I do not know that for sure, but they used two pages in the catalog, and they just called it Delta 14-inch saws for fast economical cutting of woods and metal. And notice up here it says now the Delta 14-inch saw gives you 8 cutting speeds, starting at 40 feet per minute up to 3,000. Now, the 3,000 was the speed for wood cutting, and there was only one speed for that, but 7 speeds for metal cutting. So let me zoom in and show you some of the specs on that. If anyone is still watching, I thank you, because I do spend an incredible amount of time doing this research, so I hope more than 3 people are watching. But this again is the metal cutting, and with a 1725 motor, the slowest speed is 40, then 60, 85, 115, 160, 220, and 335, and then the 3000 again for wood. So there was a very wide range of speeds and super slow speeds with this model, and I believe this is the same general manufacturing principle that they used in Richard's saw that we just examined. Please pause your video and read this, or look at the still at the end of the video. But look here at what it says. In fact, I'm going to bore you and read this. The Delta 14-inch metal wood-cutting bandsaw incorporates a completely new and modern drive. A special feature of this new drive is the unique multi-dog clutch that permits instant changes from direct gear to drive gear or vice versa by simply shift of a knob. V-belts are not disturbed, so they're making a big deal over the fact that you don't have to mess with the V-belt. So that is a great improvement, and they, in a way, they're kind of admitting that their earlier version was not particularly good. And I found information about the earlier version in the 1940s catalog, so this was already available during the Second World War, or the older model was. So this is a very, very old design saw for woodworking that I believe was introduced in the late 30s. These aren't very good pictures, but this is the 1991 Delta catalog found on vintage machinery, and I'm sure this is the identical model that Richard has, or maybe it came is a little bit newer than that. But in the newer models, all of the doors on the bandsaw were hinged. Now that was such a major, major improvement, and that is what caused me to keep the saw that I now have over there, and I sold the older saw that you had to remove four knobs in order to remove the two separate guards, and that was really a pain in the neck. But probably 90% of all the saws that they made over the years were the old design without hinges. And here are the specifications in 1991, and I believe they are the same as what I showed you in the catalogs from the 50s. The only thing they changed, and it's rather pathetic at that, that they had to list them in metric as well. Okay, I've shown you all the specifications and catalog pictures and bored you to death with that. Now I'm going to go into some of the exploded views that I also found on vintage machinery, and I'm going to start with the older model, which again is different than the newer models. This is the parts breakdown dated 1946, and it was revised in 46. So there is the arrangement of the pulleys and the gears. Notice here that we have the large gear and, of course, a smaller gear, and there is the lever to disengage it, and this is where the pulleys are placed for slow speed, and as far as I understand then, a larger, longer belt, and we just would avoid these that would go around this big pulley to give you direct drive or full speed. Also, you will notice that there are no dog clutches, and that's what is the main difference with the newer model, which I'm going to show you here presently. Again, if I didn't already say it, there is a very large gear and there is the smaller pinion gear. This is strictly off topic, but I have talked many times over the years about the overarm on the saw. This is the older model where the overarm was more tubular, not flat-backed, as I have shown you in my videos. And in order to make this casting, it would have been much, much more expensive, I'm sure, because it incorporated a core. So the arm is hollow, but I think that it probably was more rigid, but I'm just deducing that. I don't really know. I'm surmising, if you will. Back to the business. Okay, here is the exploded view of Richard's model, the latest model. It uses two dog clutches. You cannot tell that at all in this particular view, but I'm going to show you a close-up that is very, very good on that if you're interested. But again, here you can see that there is a small gear and a large gear. And then out here is that knurled knob that I showed you when I was in the neighbor's garage, that you could pull in and pull out, and that engaged and disengaged those dog clutches. Let's have another view. These two views of the dog clutches, both engaged and disengaged, tell the whole story. I hope that you take the time to read this and study it. Now I'm going to move in close up and try to explain what's going on in these two particular views. When cutting wood at 3,000 feet per minute, this is the position here, and the knurled knob is pulled out in that direction. And when the operator does that. This dog clutch is engaged for direct drive now, and this one is disengaged, and that all happens in one motion. So this is direct drive. That is, the power is going right through the pulley and into the lower wheel at a very high speed. So when the operator wants to slow it down, he simply pushes in on the neural knob. Now, in order for dog clutches to engage, sometimes you have to rotate the pulley or the wheel or whatever. You know that. But when pushing in on the neural knob, it disengages this dog clutch and at the same time engages this dog clutch, which then couples that shaft onto this big bull gear at the top. And then the rest is all history. Did you like that? Now here's a picture, and I'm just comparing the simplicity of the standard wood cutting compared to the wood slash metal cutting saw. But this is the wood cutter like I have here in my basement, 10 feet from me. Look at the simplicity of the casting and the shaft and the pulley and all of that. And you can see how that would be significantly cheaper than this one. Hang on. Of course, you've already seen this picture, but look at all the parts and the expense involved in building the built-in gearbox with all the different parts, the gears, a much different casting here that can hold oil, and extra pulleys and belts and all that. So that would be quite costly, and all that cost is passed on to you. For over a decade, I wanted to make this video explaining the difference between the two different saws, and thank you to Richard for buying that saw from Lost Creek Machinery. Check out their website so that I could do this, but I just wish that his saw was in running condition there with a three-phase converter so I could have showed you that. And that may happen in the future, that I get over into his other garage where he has the three-phase converter, and we can run that saw with a metal cutting blade. That was not a metal cutting blade on there, to see how bad his chatter was. But overall, I believe that these Delta saws were a disappointment, at least to me and my brother and maybe other people. But possibly it wasn't a disappointment. I've said this before, if you are used to Dewall and Grobe industrial bandsaws, super heavy duty, you would be disappointed in these saws. But if you've never used them, you're going to love them. So anyway, that being said, hope you enjoyed the video. You know, I just got hundreds and hundreds of other videos that are languishing out there. Give them a try. And if you like this video, give me a thumbs up and click on that bell icon and all of that crazy stuff that YouTube makes you do. So it's Mr. Pete saying so long, and I'll see you next time if the good Lord is willing.